Good afternoon, Madam President. Welcome to this interview and thank you for coming this afternoon.
Thank you very much, Victoria. It's a pleasure to be interviewed by you, and I really must say I'm indebted for your time.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
It's been almost a year since the last presidential election, and you did not give the people the common promises everybody promises. Instead, your campaign focused on empowering the people and decentralizing government. We have elections coming up next year. Is that still your main focus? And if so, why?
You see, what has happened to our country is that we have a bloated government. If the president can openly say that deputy ministers will sit in cabinet, there are 60. And upwards of about 25 cabinet ministers. And each cabinet minister has a permanent secretary, two or three. And each ministry has two or three deputy ministers. You can imagine such a meeting room. It's equivalent to a public rally. How do you expect to achieve anything in a crowd like that? The nature of decision making requires that people know what they are called upon to do. One, there is a problem in the placement of manpower. I am a believer in women empowerment, for example. But I tend to think that in Zambia, they will take a very educated woman. I mean, for example, my sister Dora, she would be better, she would perform better, for example, in media and broadcasting. They give her a job of energy minister. And it's not that she is inefficient or anything. I think the idea there is to make her fail. Then they will turn around to us women in Zambia and say, we gave you a job and you didn't perform. Misplacement of manpower. And that is rampant in this government. Because all they are trying to achieve is allocate jobs to each other. And this has created this heavy burden of red tape. The public service, who are supposed to be excellent and performing well, they've folded back their hands. They can't get policy decisions passed by their ministers, and this has created huge red tape. It's an inefficient machinery, and the only way to get rid of this inefficiency is to decentralize. Our mission has not changed from 2001 to date. And to the future, I will only rest if and when we can break this overhang on Zambia, where a few people in Lusaka think that Lusaka is Zambia and Zambia is Lusaka. And those that are in Lusaka feel that they must control the resources for the people of Zambia. I think it's one of the major mistakes that we have made in the last 51 years, where we have told our people that central government is the answer and failed to impart the very clear message to our people that hard work with support from the central government is what will eradicate poverty. The size of government now emphasizes a point we make. When we decentralize, the MPs will have no need to be job seeking here. They'll be seeking jobs from where they come from. Right now, they stay in Lusaka for 11 months in a year, and they cheat their constituents that they are at parliament. When they are at parliament motel, taking cheap drinks and doing nothing. When they go back to their constituencies, most of our rural MPs have nothing to take back to their constituencies. That's why they hang around Lusaka. Our mode of development says we have parliamentary session for 1 month. The rest of the time, because we are just allocating money in block numbers, we will say Gwembe district, 40 billion. We allocate it in bulk, and it goes to the people in Gwembe. They have a council there, and the council and the central government functionaries form the executive of that arrangement. The elected officials, who are the MPs and the councillors, have to sit there and decide who gets what, where, and how. They would have no need to be here because they know that there will be money in Chulubi. Contracts will not be issued by PPAZ in Lusaka. Contracts will be issued in the districts. I am 100% sure that even at the West, my grandchild in Chiluvi will be given a small job to push a wheelbarrow. I'm 100% sure that if I could send block amount of allocation to Chiluvi, the Chiluvi people, the people in Chiluvi, my relatives in Chiluvi, will not give a contract to a Chinese, a Senegalese. They will first look around. Who amongst us can do the job of carpentry? They will give them the job to do the doors. Who can do bricklaying? That way you are also creating jobs. So this over-centralization of government has its own evils. All these ministers have to have 4x4s, their wives and husbands have to have 4x4s. The households now have become part of government. You find that one minister's provisions are beyond what you can allocate to a clinic in Chilenje. One minister's office is eating more money than Chilenje clinic. And I mean, where are we going? So this basically is because we, the people of Zambia, have authorized outright looting of our resources. Through the constitution, we say to ourselves, only one person is important, and that's the presidency. And we allow him to send his minister to parliament to say he's a bearer of the message from the president, recommending looting of public resources. Because when they allocate these resources, they allocate them in back, Minister of Education. Does someone in Muyombe know how much has been allocated to education? None. So, but for us, we say the people in Muyombe must know there's so much money. And then they must sit and say, this year, the most important activity is agriculture. Next year, we'll do education. Or let's do education, agriculture, and energy. Who doesn't know that in Muyombe right now, somewhere there are huge reserves of coal on the ground, but there's no money. If we give them money, they may allocate $1 million to do exploration of coal reserves in Muyombe. And that's why America is successful, because they have many states with independent administrations, administrative structures, and together they form the United States of America. It doesn't mean that when President Obama wakes up, he must think on behalf of that state. There are governors in that state. They think, they plan. When one state is bankrupt, you can easily see that Michigan is bankrupt because the governors in there are not able to turn the economy around. But when Michigan is bankrupt, it doesn't mean that New York is also bankrupt. At least you can save something. Now, as a country, we are bankrupt. The pangs of poverty are being felt in every village. Fertilizer is 500 kwacha. 500 kwacha for 50 kilograms. Cooking oil has moved up from as little as 10 kwacha to 18 kwacha. A tablet of soap, which was three kwacha, is now 8 kwacha 50. A bag of mealie meal is 85 kwacha instead of 20 kwacha. And what is the reason? It's because someone failed us by not planning for our future. When we tell them, please manage the fiscal policy, they say we are insulting them. When we tell them that the people in Mugubudu don't understand what copper is and what copper looks like, they would rather do fish farming. They would rather grow cotton. They would rather grow bananas. Someone thinks, oh, those people in FDD are mad. But you see, there's got to be a time when the people of Zambia can rise up and say, enough is enough. They too, God gave them capacity to think for themselves.
Your party logo is a leaf, which represents the agricultural sector. Why do you feel the agricultural sector is more important than any other sector for Zambia right now?
I dream of a country where the future will not depend on copper, because copper has been mined in our country, not for 51 years, but for over 8 years, 80 years, since Cecil Rhodes landed in Africa and found home to Zambia. The first copper ingots were made and manufactured in our country. And yet, if you go to a rural area like Namshakende, you go to Nakonde, you go to Chama, you go to Chinyinji, you go to Samfia Bangweulo, you will not find any family any household or any chiefdom that has been impacted by our heavy reliance on copper. All we feel as a country is that we are impoverished because of our reliance on copper. If you look at the exchange rate, it has gone off the roof because of copper. I dream of a country where we can drive this economy through agriculture and energy. Almost 75% of our people in this country live off the land. And when we have a government that can inspire our people to use the land, then we will be a country that will have pride. If you look at countries which have moved forward, Japan, India, they've moved forward because of the Green Revolution. But even in Zambia, pick a year when we were doing well. You can pick 1999. Pick a year when we had the so-called bumper crop. The economic indicators were always positive. We would always record positive growth. Our people would have food. Our people would be happy. But pick a year like now when we didn't grow enough food. You can feel the hunger, the pangs of hunger in the homes, in the houses, in the hospitals. You can feel that our people are hopeless. They don't have the money. They don't have the food. And therefore, the solution for Zambia and Africa is nothing but agriculture, driven by a vibrant energy sector, which is premised not on hydrocarbons, but on renewable energy.
You have been a very loud voice in the media, openly criticizing the president and the current government on a number of occasions. Don't you feel that this has been a little harsh and counterproductive to your successful 2014-2015 campaign?
President Edgar Lungu says he has no vision, and I agree with him, he has no vision, because he was giving South Africa as an example where people are having power shortages. But we know, as we're talking now, that South Africa is no longer load shedding, because they have a leader there who could foresee shortages in power, and they started putting up new power station on stream. And I think three months ago, they put on stream close to 800 megawatts. I think last month they brought another 13,000 megawatts on stream. They're no longer load shedding. That is a country with people with vision. But for us, they are telling us, well, we are going to have power shortages for the next 5 years. They premise the power supply for this country on Kariba. But that's not the only source of energy. We can do biogas, we can do solar generation, we can actually generate power from the northern sector of Zambia, such as in the Luapula River. We can generate power from farm waste. You can cut these flowers, take the petals, and use the leaf to generate electricity. It is done in Kenya, and our president has visited Kenya. He doesn't say, President Uhuru, can you take me to this small farm where people are generating electricity from rose stems? He doesn't do that. Most of our leaders now, they would rather visit a country and enjoy the presidential suites and not be able to explore and feel how other people do things.
And what is your take on the drying up of the Kariba Dam? Do you feel, even if it was caused by a natural calamity, it would have been avoided due to planning?
I want to categorically say that, yes, there have been a drought. That's given. But the Kariba empties in 5 years and fills in 5 years. Any hydrologist will tell you that one dry spell in a season of 6 months will not empty the Kariba Dam. The Kariba Dam was emptied because of ineptitude. They imported turbines from China. They did not calibrate them. You see, it's a very simple theory. What happened is that the turbines were drawing more water than they should have been, because those turbines which they imported were not designed for that type of system. They should have gone back to the original suppliers of the turbines and got retrofits, or in fact maybe refurbished the old one. So when they opened those turbines, they were drawing water like thirsty sponges, and the dam was emptied. That's why the shock was so sudden. So, as far as I'm concerned, we can't continue to cry and say the Kariba is emptied. It is bound to be emptied when you open the spillway, when there's a disaster on the dam, maybe it breaks. You need to plan and say, this dam one day will shut down. What are the options?
This has been a very interesting interview, Madam President. But please run us through what we expect from you in 2016 as FDD.
You expect from us ideas that should advance our cause as a nation. I have observed most political parties, and the people in Zambia are conditioned to thinking that the loudest mouth is the winner, and that's a mistake we have made. People for a long time have been voting with their hearts. Right now, we are on the ground telling our people that decentralization is the solution. And when we explain, they understand. We, as a party, have bought a lot of seed, thanks to our supporters. We are distributing soybean seed, we are distributing sunflower seed to show that you can grow sunflower, you can make cooking oil, you can use the soya cake for animal feed, you can be better off with your pocket. That is the best way to put money in people's pocket. If I had the power today as head of state, I would go to the central bank, draw down the reserves, take all that money and finance agriculture for next year. Next year, we are going to have massive hunger. And unfortunately, it's election year. But this government, for all it is worth, they don't care about agriculture, which means they don't care about the people. And for us, what you expect when we are in office is that agriculture is going to be breakfast, lunch, and supper. The word agriculture, and agriculture for us is not maize. Agriculture to us means fish farming. It means livestock. It means other crops such as soya. If this year Zambia could grow all the soya beans we can get our hands on, would export all of it to Botswana? If you go to these shops which are selling animal feed, there's absolutely nothing. The cost of rearing chickens has gone up because there's no feed because of this so-called dollar impact. But the foreigners are coming here and discounting the dollars and going away with money. If as a country we could grow enough food, we'd feed the region. If as a country we could get ourselves in a situation where we could grow and keep goats, we would be sending huge aircrafts to the Middle East. Our friends in Botswana are doing that. What really hates me is that most of our people around us, other countries, have emerged from behind and overtaken us. This is a classic case where someone doesn't understand that food, in terms of politics, food is a tool that you can keep a country stable. In all its worth, Henry Kissinger said that when you can control food, you can control the people. And unfortunately, this government is using food to try and control people. You can see it when it's election time. They go there with sweets, with food, with chibuku. That is exactly using Kissinger's policies that food is a tool of control. And they've understood that philosophy and they use it. As a political party, what will you see? You will see a clear movement from the center to the outside. You will see me this year inspecting fields of our sisters and brothers planting soya, supervising them so that they do the correct thing. This year you will see us launch a program on growing crops, on keeping livestock. Even as a political party, this is the little that we can contribute to improve the knowledge of our supporters that they can be better off. That it's not all the time about vote Nawakwi, vote Edgar Lungu. We must spend a little bit of time to better our people in the areas.